So, sir, 3 years ago, we sat down in an interview to review your first year in command. Thank you for sitting down with me again today to reflect back on your nearly 4 years now at AMC and your distinguished 36-year Army career.
It's been 36 years.
Sir.
Wow. And it's been 4 years.
Yes, sir.
How time flies. It doesn't seem like that.
Yes.
But yes, it's 36 years and 4 years this past Sunday on the 7th of August. So it's been a remarkable time and remarkable journey.
So you commanded AMC for nearly 4 years. Before mm-hmm. that, served as deputy commander. What's your overall assessment of the organization today?
It's a phenomenal organization, and I stand in awe of it every day. As I travel and I assess the mission that AMC is performing, the multiple missions AMC is performing around the world, it's very hard to get your arms all around it. And I think because I have been in command, been blessed to be in command for 4 years, and serving previously as a deputy, I've been able to live it each day. But every now and then I pause and reflect on just the enormity of the mission, the global responsibilities that we have, the multiple missions that we're supporting and contingencies around the world. And so it's pretty fascinating, but it's a magnificent organization.
Yes, sir. So the retrograde of equipment out of Afghanistan, it was mm-hmm. in full swing when you arrived here as the deputy, and of course continued on in your early years in command as the commanding general. How did AMC handle that enormous mission?
Well, you know, when I arrived at AMC as the deputy, I'd been on the ground for about 3 months when General Dunwoody had me go forward and lead the effort in the final stages of the retrograde out of Iraq. And at that point in time, there was a structure in place, but the amount of equipment and the timeline that we were given to move that, it was moving a mountain of equipment. But we had the right people in place to plan it. We had the right strategic partnerships with U.S. Transportation Command, with the Service Deployment Distribution Command, with the Defense Logistics Agency. And we worked very well with the commanders on the ground, because that's what it took to begin that process. And so, as you know, we moved billions of dollars of equipment out of Iraq. And then we began part of the retrograde out of Afghanistan. And that continues to this day as we're still involved in operations. And so it's ongoing. But there were so many lessons learned. We perfected, I think, retrograde operations here at the command. We were able to see ourselves and see the equipment and know where it needed to go, more importantly, because removing it from the theater was just the first phase from a landlocked theater. But moving it to the right ports and facilities and to the right depots and arsenals to reset it and refurbish the equipment to prepare for future missions. So it was an enormous task. But as I say, it continues this day and can only be done by the great professional logisticians and a great Department of the Army civilians working with our contractor teammates that made it possible.
So on that same note, as we drew down forces from Afghanistan mm-hmm. after a sustained conflict for many, many years, had some significant impacts on the organic industrial base. We've
yes.
heard you talk a lot about the organic industrial base. Talk about some of those impacts that the drawdown of that sustained conflict had on the
sure.
OIB.
Well, the organic industrial base, these 23 depots, arsenals, and ammunition plants that I've referred to here in the last year as a national security readiness insurance policy. That came to me in terms of just how important these facilities are to the national security, and often taken for granted because they're behind the scenes. Not a lot of fanfare, great patriots at work there, but provide a unique state-of-the-art capability that we need to maintain readiness of our forces. And so those facilities been around since the Civil War. Grew significantly during World War II to about 77 facilities, and now we have 23. I think it is the right mix of the type facilities that we have. And they've been able to reset billions of dollars of equipment for not just the Army, but for all the services that continue to do so today. And so the challenge has been to maintain the workload. As we peaked in the workload in those facilities around 2008, at about 42 million direct labor hours. Today we're approaching 16 million. But we've been able to sustain that through a series of public-private partnerships, working with and leveraging foreign military sales, because these facilities are viable to the future readiness of our Army, and they're vital to security of the nation. And I think that's resonating now with many people as we expose these facilities and the personnel who work there and the capabilities they deliver. I think it's getting more recognition today of just how important and how critical they are to national security.
So also early on in your tenure as our commanding general, mm-hmm. the Army began moving toward regionally aligned forces and the RAF concept. What was AMC's response to this new regional alignment around the globe?
Well, fortunately for AMC, when the chief of staff at the time, General Odierno, moved to the regional aligned concept, because of the great vision of a former commanding general AMC, General Ben Griffin, as we were supporting wars primarily in the CENTCOM theater, the war in Iraq and Afghanistan, he stood up brigades, AMC field brigades, in every combatant command. And so we had a footprint already in place in those theaters, and we grew the contracting workforce, the contracting brigades, and then the transportation brigades, the Service Deployment Distribution Command. And so AMC's global stance was already there, in place, already in support of the Army Service Component Commands and the combatant commands when General Odierno directed to go to the regional line force. And so our focus then shifted to ensure that we had modernized pre-positioned stocks of equipment, because we knew we would deploy forces, but the likelihood is they would fall in on equipment that was already in theater, and they would train with that equipment. And then we were directed to build activity sets, which were brigade, battalion and brigade sets of equipment that were used to enhance the training of our forces as they deployed. Little did we know that shortly after, General Odierno had given us the directive to build this battalion, armored battalion set in Europe. And about a year later, because we had moved out swiftly and built that set, we had no idea when Russia annexed Crimea that we would be deploying a battalion from the 1st Cavalry Division at Fort Hood. And in the span of 4 days, that battalion deployed, fell in on that equipment, and they were out training with Latvia, Lithuania, Poland, and Germany. And when you think about that, from a, given that mission at a one-year point, and then, of course, having that battalion deploy, I think it was because we were already postured to support the mission. We've expanded that greatly since that directive now, not only in Europe, but in the Pacific. We're building capability in the Southern Command, in AFRICOM. We're rotating forces to Korea now. And so AMC plays a critical role, not only in supporting the forces when they get there. AMC also is involved as we move from port to fort, fort to port, as they leave an installation, whether it's by rail or by ground transport down to a port facility, and then move on to wherever that deployment's going to be, or to an airfield. And so I think the stance that we had, I think having the right experts, having the right processes in place, has enabled the regional line force concept to be extraordinarily successful. And each combatant commander will tell you today that they want a regional line force that's rotating to their theater, and they want equipment positioned there. And I think that's the role we've been able to perform very, very well.
So in 2011, AMC was designated as the lead materiel integrator, the LMI. How have we matured that role in your 4 years as our commanding general?
Well, of course, the Secretary of the Army designated AMC as the lead materiel integrator. At the time, we had multiple systems, we had multiple organizations, we had multiple people processing and managing and distributing equipment and materiel. We couldn't see it. We had mountains of equipment located in various places throughout the United States and overseas. And so in terms of material distribution, being able to determine the equipment we're removing from Iraq and Afghanistan and in Kuwait and other locations around the world, and then moving it where it would need to go to meet future requirements, LMI allowed us to be able to have this single repository of logistics and equipment information. And so we've grown that now, developed it, several phases of the software that they developed, a decision support tool that now every corps and division and brigade combat team, logistics staff has visibility. And so today we can see our equipment around the world. And because we can see it, we can quickly respond to directives from the Department of the Army to move that equipment where it needs to move. We become much more efficient in predicting where that equipment goes in terms of if something leaves the theater of Iraq or Afghanistan, we know exactly which port it's going to. We know where it will arrive in the United States. We know which depot or arsenal that equipment will be taken to be refurbished. We also know which unit it will go to eventually, 6 to 18 months down the road. So that's predictive readiness. And we've never had that in the United States Army before. And so I'm very proud of the folks who've worked on that system, who now allow us to be able to truly see and manage the Army's equipment. And that's millions of pieces of equipment. And we can do that not only here in the United States, we can do it from a global standpoint as well.
So on that same note on automation, you know, we recently unveiled, if you will, the Logistics Modernization Program, yes. Increment 2, and gets to the shop floor a little, yes. bit more. Talk about LMP.
Well, that's, again, just a phenomenal success. And really for the folks here in the command who worked that program, I was briefed on it initially when I arrived in 2011. And it's been 5 years now. And so now we have that automation down to the shop floor in our depots and arsenals. We've never had that before. It replaces where we would manually track parts from a screw to a tank, just all the equipment material. You can imagine just the thousands of items, millions of items that we were tracking manually. And now we have an automated system to be able to do that. It will replace multiple systems that we were using before. It's going to save us billions of dollars, and what we would have lost in trying to maintain the old systems will allow us to be more efficient now in the conduct of our operations as we schedule and order supplies and materiel to perform the mission in our depots and arsenals. We can see that now in a more predictive manner, and allow us to be able to get rid of stocks that we don't need. And again, at the end of the day, LMP will save the Army and the Army Materiel Command billions of dollars that we otherwise would be spending either to maintain material that we don't need or not being efficient enough to project what we will need as we go forward. And so I'm very proud of what the team has done with that program, and it leads any other service in the Army because they stay with it. And in the early days, there were many calls to just drop the program. You know, we've had to sunk costs, but we had some great people in AMC who stayed with it. They worked with the PM. And so while it's not perfect, it today is delivering incredible, contributing to readiness across the force.
Yes, sir. So another logistics effort that streamlined operations, the name change of what was previously Directorates of Logistics.
Yes.
Why make that change, and what's the impact been?
Well, the transfer of the Director of Logistics to AMC was a multi-year effort. The decision was made in October 2012, I think it was, to transition the former Director of Logistics from MCOM to AMC. And it really was aligning core competencies. AMC is involved in maintenance and sustainment. These Director of Logistics were on Army installations. We had capabilities on Army installations with our Army Field Support Brigades and Battalions. And so it made sense to do that and leverage the core capabilities of AMC. But it was a multi-year effort. Bureaucracy sometimes prevents you from being able to move forward. But then when we received that mission, we then wanted to ensure that there was one touch point for AMC, because on every post-campus station, and we initially started, I think, with 73, we had organizations and personnel from the Aviation and Missile Command, from the Security Assistance Command, from the Communication Electronics Command, the Tank and Automotive Command, and so a contracting person from the Army Contracting Command. So we had personnel that were on these installations providing AMC support. And so having been on the other side most of my time in uniform being a commander wants to be able to turn to one person in a particular organization to request support or to work through issues. And so that's when I made the decision to establish the Logistics Readiness Center. And what it really did is put an umbrella over all of AMC's capabilities that already resided on an installation of Fort Hood or Fort Bragg. And we just folded the Director of Logistics under that. It gained efficiency, so we could see where we had duplication of work, where the former DOLs were performing work that AMC was performing. And so in the process, we've been able to save the Army about $300 million a year. There were concerns that we were going to end up losing a lot of people, and we didn't. We just restructured our personnel and our workforce to align with the Army inactivation of brigade combat teams and the restructuring of the Army as they moved units throughout the United States. Then we could reshape that workforce to meet the requirements. And so it's been a win-win situation. When I travel now to a corps or a division, even to a brigade, they know the colonel that they can reach out to. They know the department civilian that they can reach out to for issues and concerns with maintenance, transportation, supply, dining facilities. And so it's allowed us to be better integrated, better synchronized, and be able to better deliver capabilities to the soldier and to those units and be responsive to their needs, which are constantly changing each and every day.
Yes, sir. Well, we've certainly faced our challenges as well. Mm-hmm. We can't talk about the last several years without talking about the Budget Control Act and sequestration. How did you navigate AMC through these challenging times?
Well, product of my experience, and when I came into the Army, I was, fortunately for me, I was in a unit that did not have a lot of resources. And I learned early on as a young second lieutenant and as a young maintenance officer how to accomplish the mission and manage the resources that you had. We couldn't afford to have parts in the bins that you didn't put on your vehicles. We couldn't afford to order parts that we could not afford. And I learned to manage a budget early on as a young captain, and then on into my service as a major and then a battalion commander. I knew how to manage a budget, and I knew how to set priorities and meet our requirements. And so having served in the Pentagon and the Army G8, I've been in the Pentagon twice, really three times. I've lived through the eras where we had a lot of funding and when we didn't have a lot of funding. And just like you do at your home, the time when you're doing okay with your resources, you have to put some away.
Yes, sir.
You can't spend everything. Otherwise, the rainy days will come and you'll be challenged. And so when sequestration came, you know, with the law, the Budget Control Act, I knew we were going to face significant challenges in AMC. You know, in terms of personnel reductions, which happens after every war, I knew with our force being about 96% civilian, 4% military, that we were going to have to go through some reductions. I also knew that based on the changing nature of conflict around the world, that we were going to continue to have quite a few missions. And the mission did, in fact, increase. We're busier today than we were when we were supporting two wars simultaneously. because we were focused on one theater. Now we're focused on six theaters, and simultaneously we have operations going, as well as training here in Home Station and at our national training centers. And so my approach was, how do we ensure that we meet our mission requirements while also taking care of our workforce? And I remember the town hall that I had when I talked about sequestration, especially after the government shut down and the furloughs, which is probably one of the more challenging periods for the command, and especially for the morale of our employees, not just here at Redstone Arsenal, but employees around the world for AMC. And so I knew we needed to put in place a strategy to better position us down the road, the command down the road. And so that's when we, one, prioritized the mission requirements, ensure that we were performing missions that were our core competencies and not additional missions that we had taken on because we had resourcing to do so, someone asked us to do it, perform that mission, and just like great professionals, we have a hard time to say no. But over time, we were performing missions that weren't truly the core competencies of AMC. And so we had to divest ourselves of some of those additional missions that we were performing, reimbursable work for other organizations. And then we had to look at how we could reduce our workforce. And we set about a plan to leverage our turnover. AMC transitions about 2,300 people a year through retirements or people who decide to transition to a new job or a new location, or just have a change in career. And so we're able to reduce the roles of our workforce by 10,000 per personnel. We did that without a reduction in force. We did that without it being impact on any mission that we have. It was very transparent to the warfighter that we were supporting. No one saw any reduction in support. I think we were able to maintain the morale. And today, we're in a much better position that if sequestration returns, because it is a 10-year law, that if it returns, we think we can manage our way now through the remainder of the sequestration years. And so that was the approach. It was very difficult because most organizations, when they have a mission, they don't want to divest themselves of that mission. Or if they're performing workload in one of our depots and arsenals, they don't want to give up that workload. And so being able to get the buy-in of the leadership to have them understand why we needed to move in that direction. And there was a little apprehension at first, but I think as we moved along, we were able to reinforce that we in fact could continue to accomplish the mission and also take care of our workforce, not either or. And so today, we're in a very good posture, should sequestration return.
Yes, sir. Just a few more questions on your incredible 4 years here. Mm-hmm. So we've heard you talk a lot about the importance of research and development, yes, overmatch and next generation technologies, yes, and of course, all during a very challenging budget time. How are we doing when it comes to that R&D?
Yeah. I think we still have work to do on setting priorities. And a reason the challenge is there is we've been accustomed to a period of sustained funding over time. And therefore, we haven't become accustomed to the lean years. And again, as I talked about my experience, we haven't reached that point yet. We're gradually getting there, but I think we're still challenged in truly setting priorities. Where we've done that extraordinarily well is in the organic industrial base. We have designated locations that we call SITE, Centers for Industrial Technical Excellence. And so what that means is that at Anderson Army Depot, they're refurbishing and resetting tanks and Bradley's Stryker vehicles. They're not building communications equipment. That's being done up at Toby Hanna. Toby Hanna is designated as a site for C4ISR and those type systems. And then, of course, you have Corpus Christi, that's designated a site for all aviation helicopters. Letterkenny, designated for missile systems. And I've not named them all, but the point I'm getting across is that they're not competing against each other for workload. They prioritize, they specialize, and they become the centers of excellence for technical excellence for those particular areas. The challenge I think we have today still is, what is the future requirement? And it's very difficult to look out and determine what you may need 10, 15, 20 years down the road for a future Army, while also meeting the current requirements. And so we are moving in that direction as TRADOC announces the Big Six and where we should be placing our priorities. And I think as we move towards supporting the six, the Big Six, and moving through DOTLM PF, doctrine, organization, training, leader, personnel, facilities, going through that process to determine where we should invest our resources to meet a future threat while also still maintaining capabilities that we have today. And so we have some work to do. And I think it's a little change in the culture. I was speaking with someone about this here just recently, that I think we do have to come together and determine what are the priorities that we need to work on. What will a battalion commander need 10 years from now? How do we enhance mobility of the systems that we have, protection? How do we do that and provide them more capability to be able to perform their mission? So a little bit more work to go there.
How does your innovation campaign that you kicked off just this year, how does that play into that?
Well, the intent for the innovation campaign was to get at that, to help us, one, determine, first define innovation, because it's a word that could be overused and you hear a lot about innovation, being innovative. But mainly it's to determine, first define what we mean by innovation, and then determine what are the detractors from being able to be innovative in the Army. And so we had, I had our chief technology officer look at establishing a campaign. Initially he thought I meant every 6 months or to have a innovation summit. And I said, no, I want one every quarter. And initially I want the group to be small, to define innovation, determine what the inhibitors are to being innovative in the force, and then determine where we need to go and what's available from technology, what's available from industry, and what do we have available organically. And so then the second forum built on that, and we invited other elements across the Army to come and participate. And that was held at RDCOM up at Aberdeen Proving Ground, Maryland. And so the third summit, which will be next week, is being held in Williamsburg on the College of William & Mary. And this particular forum will extend invitation, we have extended invitation to industry and to academia. So now we're expanding now this discussion about innovation and what are the inhibitors to being innovative in the Army and what's available, what's in the art of possible in the technologies. And then hopefully that will help the Army, inform the Army on where we should be investing our dollars for the future. So we're looking forward to the one next week. I'm going to co-host that with General Dave Perkins. And so it's AMC and TRADOC. It's an Army forum. It's just AMC initiated this effort, but it's an Army campaign. It's not just about what's important for AMC in terms of innovation, it's for the Army at large.
Recently, sir, you announced the mission command alignment within AMC. What did you hope to accomplish with that alignment?
Well, again, it gets back to the priorities that we were just talking about. And we had become accustomed over a period of time, I think we overly decentralized across not just AMC, but across our Army. And what I found, and this just didn't start a year ago. I found this when I was a deputy And of course, when I assumed command, we had organizations, they're pretty much stovepipe, and the efforts that they were working. I couldn't make the link between the work they were doing and how that was linked to the Army's priorities. I had the Chief Staff of the Army's priorities, I had the Secretary's priorities. I would attend the forums where TRADOC would brief their priorities and ASALT would brief their priorities. But what I found in reality is that we had a lot of people doing a lot of work, important work, but I wasn't convinced that it was aligned to the Army priorities. And previously in the Army and in AMC, we had a portfolio-based approach. So the reason that we have an Aviation and Missile Command is so that we can have one of our most experienced major generals along with that organization to look at the entire life cycle of all aviation and missile systems that are fielded to the Army. The reason we have a Communication Electronics Command is for all the communication systems, radios, satellites, or SATCOM systems, infrared devices, intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance systems. So we have a command that's focused on that from the time of research and development, working with the PMs they acquired as they filled it to the units, as we install, operate, and maintain it over its life cycle, sustain it, and then, of course, remove from inventory. The same for the Tank and Automotive Command, the same for the Joint Munitions Command. But over time, being at war as long as we were, 15 years, we have become very stovepiped in our resourcing, stovepiped in the work that we're doing. And I saw that was impacting on our ability to be able to be responsive to the critical warfighter needs going forward. And so the mission command alignment was strictly to, instead of a stovepipe approach, it was to go back to a portfolio-based approach. And many say that's back to the future. Well, that portfolio-based approach delivered the Big Five that we have today, the Big Five weapon platforms that we have today. That was the process we had in place. It improves synchronization, it improves collaboration, it allows us to work together between the commands of RDCOM, Research Development Engineering Command, the supported and their R&D center that's located along with the Lifecycle Sustainment Command and the Contracting Center. And we're already seeing, just since we've implemented it, because we operated the other way for about 15 years. Pre-9/11, that's the way we were organized. We moved away from that. And so already in just less than 6 months since we've implemented that, as I've met with our senior leaders, it has significantly improved their collaboration, their synchronization, their prioritization. They're closer now in working issues and challenges across the Army than they were before. I think they're more responsive in supporting the warfighter. They're more responsive in providing support to the PEO or the PM. And so while it certainly it's going to have to take time to develop, but I think it's on the right track to help us move towards where I think we must move if, in fact, we're going to continue to meet our requirements today while also investing in modernization and making the right investments for the future. So I'm excited about it. It does not negate in any way the role of the Army Contracting Command commander. The Army Contracting Command has 106 contracting centers around the world throughout the United States. And so that commander is very busy in being able just to visit those organizations, address the training, readiness, and oversight for those personnel, while having the assistance of a two-star general in a particular portfolio, work very closely with their contracting centers and the R&D. Same thing with RDCOM. RDCOM has about 20,000 people total around the world, over $5 billion in R&D investments. Well, again, that commander being able to meet all the international requirements, all the engagements that are required with industry and of course, in the Pentagon at the senior level, to be able to have a two-star general who is really focused on that particular portfolio and working very closely with the R&D centers. And so I think it's going to pay huge dividends for us. It will take time, but already we're seeing that we're gaining great efficiencies, synchronization, collaboration. And that's what it takes, I think, to be able to set the priorities to build the Army of 2025 and beyond.
So we've talked about a lot already today, and there's no way to touch on everything within AMC, but you know, small business, public-private partnerships, foreign military sales, all these other areas. Can you just highlight AMC in numbers? What were some of the most significant achievements and statistics from your time in command?
Well, since I assumed command, every year AMC has executed probably over 170,000 plus contracting actions, in excess of about $53 billion annually. That's what we'll see this year. We've generated about $60 billion in new business and foreign military sales. That's a growth industry. It is a win-win-win for industry, for building partner capacity and capability and interoperability with our partner nations and our allies. And it's also a win for our organic industrial base and the defense industrial base. And we see that continue to grow as we go forward. In small business, we're very proud of the fact that for two consecutive years now, we've exceeded every category in small business, averaging about $9 billion a year. And so we're approaching close to $30 billion in small business since I assumed command. Small business is the economic engine for the United States. And so we're very proud that even though our budgets have declined over time, as a percentage, we've sustained the same level. In fact, we increased small business last year by $200 million on top of what we were already executing in small business each year. So I'm very proud of that because small business opportunities out there, providing these niche capabilities and employment opportunities, as well as maintaining and meeting our requirements across the board. So it's just so much there that we all have to be very, very proud of. And it those numbers represent an enormous amount of work. That, you know, as we're right in the midst of the middle of the fourth quarter now, as for our contracting personnel, this is sort of their end of the year. You know, their new year comes on 1 October. And so the incredible amount of work that they're doing around the world, it's truly incredible.
So let's take a quick break, and when we return, we'll talk about the amazing career that you've had, 36 years.
We are AMC, the United States Army Materiel Command. AMC develops and delivers global readiness, regionally aligned and globally engaged. We provide for our Army and joint warfighters, anytime, anywhere. Our patch identifies us as the premier provider of world-class materiel readiness for the United States Army and Joint Force. We support our combatant commanders and sustain unified land operations, providing predictive readiness, assets, and resources. We coordinate and direct key industry and Army partners. Our dedicated workforce through Army field support, contracting support, and transportation brigades stands with our warfighting men and women. AMC commands the global supply chain. Our major subordinate commands define the capabilities, concepts, and opportunities to support current and future Army mission requirements and fulfill AMC's five lines of effort. Executing materiel integration, sustaining units, enhancing capabilities through science and technology solutions, cultivating a trained and ready workforce, and allocating and applying resources efficiently and effectively. These lines of effort embody AMC's four mission-critical competencies: equip, sustain, integrate, and enable. AMC's multi-skilled and globally connected team of professionals discovers, develops, and demonstrates advanced, game-changing materiel in support of our next-generation warfighter. We work to maintain our Army's technological advantage, exploring the art of the possible to increase operational effectiveness, lighten the load, and reduce risk to warfighters. As our United States Army shapes course 2025, AMC remains engaged to provide optimal support for an expeditionary, scalable, and tailored force. We enhance innovations, develop leaders, anticipate and provide critical logistical support and materiel for a globally responsive and regionally engaged Army. We are the United States Army Materiel Command, the premier provider of Army and Joint Readiness, sustaining the strength of the nation. Army Strong.
Sir, thanks again for joining us. You've had a remarkable 4 years in command here, and that's for sure. It's really been the culmination of a distinguished 36-plus year career. Take us back to the beginning of your journey. How did you become an Army officer?
Well, you know, I can tell you that this is an improbable rise for me to be at this level today, because I had no idea I was going to be in the Army. You've heard my story from a small hometown of Martinsville, Virginia. And really, I thought I was going to, it's a textile mill, small town, furniture manufacturing. That's what it was known for during that time, Bassett Furniture. DuPont, I think, had a plant there. And so I thought I was going to finish high school and get a job working in one of the factories. That's what most people did. You know, my father had not attended college, neither had my mother. And so I thought that's what I was going to do. I remember hearing some of the students, my classmates, talk about going to college around the 10th grade, and said, well, maybe that's something I want to do. But then when I went down to inquire about that, I had not taken any of the college preparatory courses. And so I enrolled in brick masonry. And I thought I was going to graduate, either get a job there or start building homes. I thought that was something I'd be interested in doing. But again, I had a great professor, teacher at the time, who saw something in me that I didn't see in myself, and Mr. Fontaine. And he said, Dennis, what about college? And I never even thought that was in the cards. And of course, he worked with a guidance counselor and with Virginia State University, and I enrolled in Virginia State. And that began my college years. And even then, I was just proud to be in college and be a part of that. My father died my freshman year, right after spring break, so that was the first time true adversity showed up in my life. And I had to grow up very fast. I had just turned 20 years old. I had a brother who was 18 months behind me, and he wanted to go to college. My mother had never worked outside the home. You know, she babysat and did other things. She never had a driver's license. She'll be 88 this year. And so I became the man of the home very, very quickly. And so as I matriculated through college at the end of my sophomore year, I happened to be walking through the Student Union building. I saw two gentlemen in this green uniform, very sharp looking, and I inquired what they did, and I said, we're in the Army. They were two majors, and I think back, and I said, well, what do you do in the Army? They told me, and it's, what are you doing this summer? You know, always a recruiter, you know. I said, well, I have to go home and make some money so I can come back to college. And they told me about this camp in Kentucky. And I had never been a Boy Scout, so I was intrigued about this camp. And I said, tell me more. This is a 6-week camp. And I said, okay. And they would pay me $500 to go to this camp. And I didn't believe it at first. I said, you got a camp and it's $500. Tell me a little bit more. And I said, well, how am I going to get there? I live in Virginia, Martinsville, and this is in Kentucky. And they said, we will fly you there. And I'd never flown on a plane. And so a plane ticket, $500, and a camp, where do I sign up? And that's what I did. And in fact, I went over, and at that time I had joined a fraternity, and I told my fraternity brothers about this great deal over in the Student Union building, and So you need to go over there and sign up because they're going to run out. I know they're going to run out. And about 8 of them did. And off we go to Fort Knox, Kentucky. Until this person in a brown hat, he's chewing us out about something. But I, you know, they say you don't get into the Army until the Army gets into you. And I loved every bit of it. I loved all the physical part of the challenge. I loved the leadership roles. I loved being a follower. I loved being in a platoon. I loved all the shooting of the weapons and all of that. And so, but I came back and I wasn't certain that that's truly what I wanted to do. But I did enroll in ROTC. It was a good course. It provided a discipline environment, a structured environment. I had some responsibilities. And so I think it tempered college years there. And then, of course, the next summer I attended another camp at Fort Bragg, North Carolina. This time I knew what I was getting into. I did very well there, came back, and then decided, let me try this for 3 years. And that's what I intended to do. I was going to come in for 3 years. And so I received my commission. My brother pinned on the bar on one of my shoulders, and my sweetheart at the time, Linda, now my wife of 33 years, she pinned the other bar. And so off I go into the Army, to Fort Gordon, Georgia, and then to Fort Bragg, North Carolina is my first assignment. And so that was the start. But again, no idea in wildest imagination that I would have spent a career in the Army, and absolutely not that I'd be one day serve at the level of a four-star general.
Was there a point in time when you knew that it was going to be a career, when you were in it for the long haul?
Yeah. Well, I had points in times where we weren't certain. You know, we were offered an opportunity after we were married while I was at Fort Bragg to be assigned in Naples, Italy, and that was a wonderful tour. I never lived overseas, never lived abroad, never traveled abroad. And so that was a wonderful assignment. And we were back in Washington, D.C. Linda had a very promising career. And we contemplated maybe it's time for me. It's been a great ride here. And we were right at about the 9-year mark. And someone whispered in my ear that I might be promoted early and that I should continue on to the Command and General Staff College. Linda and I talked about it. And so she resigned from her job and we headed out to Fort Leavenworth, Kansas. And then after Leavenworth, back to Fort Bragg again this time. And I think when I became, when I was assigned to the 82nd Airborne Division as a major, at that time General Hugh Shelton was our division commander, I think that's when I began to think, maybe I want to stay long enough to at least command a battalion. I mean, I've come this far, maybe I can command a battalion. And lo and behold, good fortune, I had a follow-on assignment to the Pentagon. And I returned to the 82nd to command the 82nd Signal Battalion. And so now I was approaching, at that time I had 16 years. And I said, okay, well, I can at least stay till 20. And then I'll decide something else to do. Well, a year into the command, maybe a little more than a year into the command, I was selected for the War College. And so, okay, well, let's go to the War College. And then I was selected for Colonel early. And then I was selected for Brigade Command, and this time to Fort Hood, Texas. And so now I'm a Brigade Commander at 20 years. And about 21 years, someone whispered in my ear and said, we think you might be able to make General. And I still didn't believe them. I said, that won't happen. I'll finish Brigade Command. I'll find something else to do. But lo and behold, it did happen. And so that turned into another assignment to the Defense Information Systems Agency, a follow-on assignment to the 5th Signal Command in Germany, a follow-on assignment as a commanding general of CECOM, and then the Joint Staff. So probably around that time when I was getting ready to go to Joint Staff, I said, yeah, this is probably a career. You know, I'm closing in on 28 years or so, and there here I had no idea I was going to be at AMC. No idea I was going to be the deputy commander here. Because when I was a J6 of the Joint Staff, 1 year into the assignment, the SecDef, Secretary of Defense, announced the stand down of my organization, along with the Joint Forces Command. And so my job went away at the 1-year mark. And I thought, okay, well, this is it. Linda and I resigned ourselves that, okay, we've had a wonderful career. It's been a great experience for us. We've met some wonderful people along the way. We've had opportunities that we never would have ever had that the Army presented to us. And so at that point in time, I was resigned to take off the third star, become a major general, which is the last rank that you're promoted to, and we were going to make our home wherever. And then I received a call from General Ann Dunwoody, whom I met when she was Major Dunwoody in the 82nd Airborne Division, when I was Captain Promotable Vi. And we'd always remain in contact over the years. In fact, when I commanded CECOM for 6 months, General Dunwoody was my boss. She was the deputy commander for AMC. And she called me, asked me about my job going away. She asked me what I was going to do, and I said, ma'am, I get that question about 8 times every day. I don't know what we're going to do. You know, we'll probably go home and we'll decide. And that's when she offered the opportunity for me to come and work for her as the deputy. I told her I'd be honored to do so. And I really thought I was going to come down to Huntsville, serve as her deputy for 2 years, which would allow me to retire as a lieutenant general. And lo and behold, a year into the job, I was, and of course, interviewed and offered the opportunity to be the commanding general. So it's something I never, ever thought would happen. I'm still humbled by it today. Sometimes I have to pinch myself that it truly did happen. So we've been truly fortunate and blessed for me to be where I am today.
So 30 plus years, you talked about many places that yes. you've been assigned. Reflecting back, what were some of your favorite locations and assignments?
You know, we say this, Linda and I, when we talk about every assignment we had was a wonderful assignment. Every location, and it was because of the people that we met. And what's a joy to us today is as we travel, people will come up and they'll say to us, we were in Germany with you all, or we were in Italy with you, or we were at Fort Hood or Fort Bragg, or we were at Fort Leavenworth, Kansas with you. We were at Fort Monmouth. We saw a couple today that said, we were on the dance floor with you all at Fort Monmouth, and we remember it. So it's always been the people where we've been, and it's always been very difficult to leave. No matter where we've been, it's always been very difficult. Now, there were certainly locations that were, you know, very special. Naples, Italy, clearly, as a young newlywed couple, only a year, I remember driving Linda along the Amalfi Coast, and I said, Linda, this is the lifestyle of the rich and famous. You know, we watch this on television, now we're here. And so Naples, Italy was wonderful as we traveled throughout the Mediterranean, places we only read about in history books. And as a young officer, I said, wow, this is pretty good. The United States Army, I'm here in Italy, and we're enjoying ourselves. So that was a wonderful tour. We enjoyed Fort Bragg, North Carolina, dear to our heart because that's where I started. As a second lieutenant, I served there 3 times. Both our boys were born when I was in the 82nd Airborne Division. The first one, Brian, the oldest, was born when I was a major there on the division staff. And I just remember, you know, certain things just stick with you. I remember doing a update briefing to General Shelton. Operation, we were updating, briefing him, and I remember him stopping, his division commander. I'm a major back on the wall with about 10 other majors, and I remember him turning around and said, Major Vi, has a baby arrived yet? And that was powerful. You know, a man of his position to take the time, and that's something you recall, just how gracious that it's about people. It's about people. The mission is always going to be there, but it's about people. And then, of course, we enjoyed Fort Hood, Texas. That was a wonderful location. We met people that we never, ever would have met had we not gone. Because I was an airborne trooper, you know, paratrooper, and all I wanted to do was jump out of airplanes and serve at Fort Bragg. But I had a mentor named Lieutenant General, deceased now, Bob Gray. He said, you need to go to Fort Hood and learn about tanks. And that's what I did. We enjoyed Mannheim, Germany. Both our boys are a little bit older then. And so, and when in Germany, I had responsibility for the entire country of Germany, where we had signal personnel located, all of Europe, as well as deploying forces to Afghanistan and Iraq. And we met so many wonderful people from all different nations. And so that was a remarkable assignment, travel opportunities. And then, of course, we enjoyed Leavenworth, Kansas. We enjoyed, been in Washington, D.C. three times. I enjoyed being at the Pentagon. That's the corporate headquarters. And many people avoided the Pentagon in their careers or would attempt to avoid. I did not. I enjoyed the time there. I enjoyed the, I mean, there's, it can be a little frustrating sometimes, the bureaucracy, but you had to fight the bureaucracy every day. But I enjoyed the assignments there. I learned, I grew. The engagement to understand how to work complex programs, how to obtain funding, how to brief, how to stand before and put your program in front of a panel of general and flag officers and get them to agree with you to go forward. Because I saw many that didn't get past that point. And so that was a wonderful assignment. And it's been wonderful here in Huntsville. We had no idea we're going to be in Huntsville, as I mentioned previously, but this is a wonderful community. They've embraced us in a great way. They truly embraced this installation. They understand the value of having this organization here. So there have been many wonderful places, but every place has been made special because of the people, and that's the way we've always felt.
So you talked a little bit about Signal Corps in there.
Yes.
You're the first Signal Corps officer to achieve the rank of four-star general. Talk about the Signal Corps and growing up as an officer within the Signal Corps.
Well, you know, you were asking me how I came into the Army and, you know, how did I select Signal? And I think what impressed me about Signal was the technology. I remember doing the camp, the advanced camp at Fort Bragg. You know, all the different branches have their equipment systems set up. And really what intrigued me about Signal is they say you can come into this shelter and you can place a phone call. Because, you know, we didn't have cell phones. Right. You know, you think today you got the iPhone and you got all the, we didn't have cell phones. You know, when you went out, you had to go to a phone booth to use the phone. And I remember going, I said, I can make a call here. Well, you know, I did. I called Linda. I said, this is great. I said, what's this branch again? Signal Corps. I, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go to Signal Corps. Because you can make phone calls. You can communicate. But I was intrigued by the technology, really, is that it was just on the forefront of so many things that we were doing, satellite communications. And so I thought that was something that I may want to do. And so I was a branch Signal Corps. And then, of course, my initial assignment at Fort Bragg and in the 35th Signal Brigade. And I enjoyed just the mission that was all involved with that. And again, you know, I'm standing on the shoulders, you know, again, being the first basic branch signal officer to attain this level, but I'm standing on the shoulders of some great general officers like Emmett Page, who was the first African-American brigadier general in the Signal Corps. He went on to become Lieutenant General Page and then eventually the Assistant Secretary of Defense for C3I. We were very honored here recently to attend a ceremony at CECOM where he was inducted into the Hall of Fame. And so General Page is just wonderful. General Bob Gray, who I met as a second lieutenant at the barber shop on at Fort Bragg on Art End Street. I remember it like yesterday when I saw this Strack lieutenant colonel, and I said, I want to be like him one day. I was a brand new second lieutenant just there, and I remember when he spoke to me, he said, Lieutenant Vi. And the first thing I said, he must know some of my people because most folks say Via. he must know, and I didn't know whether he knew me or not, but in fact he did. He knew some of my relatives in West Virginia. That's where he was from. And he was a lifelong mentor for me. I always wanted to be like him. I never had the privilege of working for him. It seemed like I was always in a different place when he was in command. But he was just a wonderful general officer. General Alonzo Short, who graduated from Virginia State, he was the first from our university to attain the rank of lieutenant general. And so another, but there have been so many others, General, that have served not only in the Signal Corps, but I've been privileged to work for so many warfighters along the way. And I mentioned General Shelton, but also General B.B. Bell, General Leon Laporte, General McKernan, General Ben Griffin. And then, of course, the privilege to work for General Ann Dunway, a remarkable leader, a great general officer, as we know, the first woman to be promoted to four-star general in the Department of Defense. And so I enjoyed tremendously working for her when I was her deputy. We just had a great time, and the best transition of anyone I've ever worked with. So I've been privileged and blessed to really stand on the shoulders of just so many great men and women who've gone forward. I remember General Julius Becton. I failed to mention him. You know, he just celebrated his 90th birthday, and just to be in his presence. General Johnny Wilson, who was a former commander of AMC. General William Ward, Kip Ward, who I had the privilege of working for three times. And so there have just been so many, and when I'm calling names, I end up missing someone, that have just been phenomenal in providing a foundation, mentoring me along the way, providing opportunities along the way. And so it's truly humbling.
Sir, you talked about this quite a bit. So one of only 8 four-star African-American generals in Army history. Mm-hmm. Talk about diversity in our Army and what you've seen in your 36-year career.
Well, the Army certainly leads our nation and leads any institution in terms of opportunities for diversity. And when you look at where our Army has come, from the time I came into the Army, which was a very challenging time right at the end of the Vietnam War. I entered the Army in 1980, and the race relations were not very good at that point in time. We really didn't see women in many of our formations at that point in time. And then you advance to where we are today. I remember when I was at Fort Bragg, North Carolina, in the 35th Signal Brigade, which at that time was probably 3,500 soldiers. I can only recall maybe 2 African-American majors that I recall. Lieutenant Colonel at the time, Gray, Bob Gray, he was the only Lieutenant Colonel that I recall on Fort Bragg. And now to advance today, to see the number of advancement in women and minorities across the Army tells a great story about how the Army embraces diversity. Not perfect, we always have to continue to grow, but just recently having 3 women complete the Ranger school. Just think about that. As I mentioned, General Dunwoody to break the ceiling on being a first 4-star woman general, and now there have been 2 or 3 others in the other services. And now we have Nadia West, who was the first African-American female lieutenant general commissioned at West Point. And then behind her, Lieutenant General Gwen Bingham, first ROTC African-American lieutenant general. And so the Army, I think, has opened up the opportunities for diversity in a huge way. But you never achieve the total, you can never check the block, say we're there. It's a constant that you have to continue to work towards providing opportunities. And irregardless of someone's background, gender, where they've lived. And so I'm very proud of what the Army has done. I know I would not be here if the Army had not provided opportunities to me along the way, but also for those who led the way and placed the foundation, or put a foundation in place for me to be at this level today.
You talked about many of your mentors along the way, mm-hmm. and I know that there were many. You've spent a lot of time personally traveling to visit schools and talk yes. to students. Why is that so important to you?
I feel that's something that I owe because of the opportunities that have been afforded to me. Had not Mr. Fontaine, a Korean War veteran, expressed an interest in Dennis Vai attending college, we wouldn't be having this conversation. I don't know what I'd be doing, but I wouldn't be sitting here. And I feel strongly that there's a quote that talent is universal, but opportunity is not. And so there are very many talented young men and women from all walks of life, but they often don't have the opportunity. They don't have someone that they can look at and say, I want to be like him or her, or I think I can do that. And if they don't see that image, if they don't see that person, then sometimes they're not going to be able to achieve their full potential because they fail to dream in what's possible. So I think in some small way, if Linda and I can go out and visit schools, read across America, I use the attempt to go. I try to go as many schools as I can, but I attempt to go to the schools where they won't see a general. They won't see someone like me or Linda. And so I want them to be able to see me. Not me as a person, but just the fact that here is this African American who has achieved this level, but also he's an Army soldier. And I think that's something that I can share and hopefully inspire someone else to be able to want to achieve their life's goal, whether that's to serve in the Army or to go become a lawyer, a doctor, become a teacher, become whatever they desire to do, but to let them know that it is possible. And it doesn't matter where you start, doesn't matter where you come from, circumstances. In the United States, you become whoever you want to become and whatever you want to do. If you set your mind to it, set goals, you work hard. There are no shortcuts. You got to work hard. And you're presented an opportunity, and then who knows where you may end up one day. And that's why it's so important for me to do so. And that's why I value having the opportunity to go out.
So many of those visits were to ROTC cadets as yes. well. I know that ROTC holds a special place in your heart. Mm-hmm. They celebrated a pretty significant milestone this year. Yes. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yes, this year is the 100th anniversary of ROTC. It began in 1917. And so it's a significant milestone for a institution or a cadre of officers that has a program that has produced over 500,000 officers, commissioned officers in the United States Army. And many of those officers have gone on to achieve very significant rank and position in the United States Army. Others have gone on to become CEOs of corporations or department heads of different governmental organizations. And so it's a great year. They had a national induction ceremony, Hall of Fame out at Fort Knox. I was very blessed to be in the number of the inductees there, representing my university. But there were so many, as you looked across and you read the bio and the list of inductees, it's even at this level, it's fascinating to be among the names in that group of officers who were recognized. ROTC, I think, is a tremendous program for the nation, not just developing officers for the nation, but really developing future leaders. I'm very interested in junior ROTC, because I think at a time when our youth are exposed to so many negative and other types of impressionable things today, that if they desire, junior ROTC provides a structured environment, allows them to be able to have responsibility early on. It builds confidence in their abilities. It teaches them how to become a good teammate, a team player. if they're not in sports. You learn that in sports, but many of our children are not involved in sports. And so ROTC provides that environment, especially junior ROTC, when they're at a point in life where they are making choices about where they're going to go in life. And what we've seen is those students who are enrolled in junior ROTC, one, they go on to graduate from high school. And second, many of them go on to be very, very successful. They go attend college. And so I think investments in junior ROTC is probably one of the best things we can do. It's not for every child, clearly, but for children, especially single parent homes, those who you know, maybe not involved in sports and maybe need someone to be able to pull out of them opportunities and capabilities that they have, that program I think is just so important. So it's a great year, it's a great milestone, and a century of success in the ROTC program is something to be very, very proud of.
Absolutely. So reflect back on your 36 years. Mm-hmm. What are you most proud of?
Well, I think I'm most proud of, from a professional standpoint, is I'm most proud of that I think in the organizations I've been privileged to lead, that I've made them a better organization. I'm proud of the fact that I was able to create an environment where people could thrive, that I've been able to build future leaders for the Army and for the nation, and personnel who served in my commands, wherever they've been, or organizations that I've been a part of. And so from that standpoint, I think it's what I've been able to contribute to others. It's what I'm most proud of and what I've been able to do. From a personal standpoint, I'm most proud of the fact that I was able to serve in the Army for this period of time and maintain my marriage to a wonderful lady who's been a lifelong partner with me from college all the way up to today, that we've been able to raise two wonderful young men, and that we moved about 23 times. They've been in multiple schools, and usually they had to move because Dad got promoted. And so I'm most proud of the fact that today I look back and I feel that we've been able to maintain this family unit. We've been able to hopefully be an example to others that you can in fact maintain a family and you can be successful in the Army. The Army is a challenging place to serve, but it also provides tremendous opportunities that don't exist in any other organization in the world. It's the most highly regarded and respected organization in the world, and so our military is. And so from that standpoint, I'm just proud to have had the opportunity to serve and hopefully make a difference in the lives of the people that I've been entrusted to lead, I've been entrusted to serve with.
I think I know the answer to this, mm-hmm. but what will you miss the most?
I'm gonna miss people. You know, I'm gonna miss soldiers. Today, even as I travel, I don't have an opportunity to interface with soldiers as much as I did when I was a junior officer. But occasionally I do, and when occasionally I'll go into, I was at Fort Belvoir and I happened to go into Starbucks and there was a group of soldiers sitting there. And I walked over to the table with my cup of coffee and sit down with them. And I'm certainly saying, why is this four-star general coming to sit down? And I told them, I said, I don't get to talk to soldiers often, so I just wanted to come over and have a conversation with you. And once I put them at ease from that standpoint, then we had a great conversation. So I'm going to miss, of course, the interaction with soldiers. I'm going to miss the opportunity to interface with units as I go out, because each time I visit, I always want to know, what can we do to help you perform your mission? What can we do better? I'm going to miss our Department of the Army civilians, who are great employees, provide tremendous capability to our Army. Army and AMC could not succeed without total team effort, and that includes the active force as well as our Guard and Reserve, but it's also our department civilians who sacrifice greatly as well to support our Army. But at the end of the day, it's going to be the people that we've been able to have the privilege to serve with And that's the part that we will we'll probably miss the most.
Sir, final question as we talk about your career in review. What legacy do you hope to leave behind, both for AMC and the Army?
Well, I think first and foremost, I think if you talk about a legacy, is that I hope that I've been able to impact in some way building the future leadership for the Army. Every organization I've always served in, always worked very, very hard to make it a better place than when I assumed that particular command or that position. And so that's the same here. From the time I arrived at AMC, what I wanted to ensure is that we selected the best leaders possible that we could bring on board to serve in this organization. And I feel like we've achieved that. We have a remarkable team across AMC, and that doesn't happen by accident. And so you can look at any part of this command, this organization, and I feel proud of the fact that people look up to the people that we have serving in the various capacities across. And when I depart the command, it should continue to strive and do great going forward, because that's truly what it's about. It's not about the senior leader of the organization. I've never felt it was that way. You have a role when you come in and assume command of an organization, but you have a responsibility that when you leave that organization, that it continues to thrive. Hopefully you put it in a better position to be, continue to be successful going forward. And so if I had any type of legacy here in AMC or across the Army, is that I hope I've done that, both in terms of our general officers, our officers, our non-commissioned officers, our warrant officers, and certainly our department civilians. And that's what I truly hope will be the legacy.
So before we transition out of that, sir, one thing that I hear with all of the transitions, and you know, I've personally experienced it on the day of the furloughs and the day of the government shutdowns, as you know, walked people out of the building and stood downstairs and shook hands with everybody. What I always hear over and over from leaders is how you've set this positive command climate. Talk about why that was important to you and what you hope to leave within the command.
Well, you know, the one thing about serving in various commands and over the time of a 36-year career, not all those command climates have been very positive. And so you learn from good as well as not so good examples. And so I think what I always wanted to do is select from the best of those organizations and leaders that I served with and emulate that in the organizations that I had responsibility for. And so I always found early on, even as a second lieutenant, is that the command climate that you set for your organization, if it is a positive, caring, supportive, and inclusive command climate, there's nothing the organization cannot accomplish. You want everyone to feel that they're appreciated, that they're important. That's from the person who cleans my office to the commanding general. I'm proud of the fact that one of the young men who cleaned my office since I've been the commanding general, he's now first lieutenant in the Army. I remember he was afraid to ask me for a letter, but he asked my executive officer, and I said, sure, I'd love to write you a letter to attend officer candidate school. And it was a proud day when he and his parents came to my office, and I told him it'd be a remarkable story down the road if you were to become the commanding general here, and you say, you know, one day, I mean, I used to clean this office, and now I'm the commanding general. But I looked at him in the eye, and I said, you can do that, though. And because you can't in our Army and in a nation that we live in. So that environment is so, so important, because people have challenges in everyday life. We're very busy at what we have to do. We have a complex mission. It's very challenging. It can be very stressful. So at least I think leaders have a responsibility to set an environment, set a climate that's positive and supportive, so that in fact people can thrive in that organization and be all they can be. That's what one of the mottos of the Army that I truly enjoyed was, be all you can be. And to me, that says it all. Every job, I always wanted to be the best. And I wanted to set that environment so others could be the best. And I think we've been able to achieve that. Not perfect, but I think we've been able to achieve that.
I think so too. All right, so let's take one more break. When we return, we'll talk about the future and take a look ahead.
Sounds good.
Soldiers in the movie rise up when they adapt to a new threat facing the world, when they find a way to win no matter what. Remember where Hollywood gets that from. The U.S. Army has been defending American independence for more than 241 years. Go to goarmy.com/independence to learn how you can join their ranks. Independence Day Resurgence in theaters June 24th.
Army Reserve soldiers use their skills to make the Army even more capable and gain the tools to make themselves even more successful. Learn how at GoArmyReserve.com.
All right, sir. So one final topic to discuss today, and that's the future.
Sure.
As you pass on the AMC colors, what do you see ahead for this command?
Well, I see continued success. AMC plays such a vital, critical role in Army readiness and in supporting and enabling our forces both here in the United States and around the world. And so that mission will continue. I think the command is postured to continue to be successful going forward. I only see that as going to expand, to be truthful with you. I think as the Army continues to build its expeditionary capability, as it continues to support regional line forces around the world, it cannot do that and perform that mission without what AMC provides. And so I think we're postured in the right way now. I think we have the right global stance. We don't have all the resources that we want, but we have what we need. And so, and as I look out in the next couple of years, we'll eventually get to the end of sequestration, but we're better postured today, as I mentioned earlier, to to lead our way and manage our way through these next few years. But I only see a bright future for the Army Materiel Command, and just so proud that I had the privilege of being able to be a part of it.
You set into motion a couple of initiatives that I think help posture that the command for success. Talk about some of those as it relates to the workforce and the internship program. And
Well, the one program that we, or initiative that we started, was the AMC 1000. And you would almost, it'd be counterintuitive at a time when we're reducing our roles, as I mentioned, by 10,000, and working our way through this reduction in budget, why would we initiate a program to hire 1,000 personnel each year, at least provide opportunities? And that's rebuilding, building the force for the future. It's regenerating the workforce. And so the AMC 1000, the intent behind that is because there was so much negative press at the time after the government shut down and the furlough, and the comments made in the press about our Department of Defense civilians. I felt we needed to put a little bit more positive spin and talk about the great work that our civilians perform for us. And so the AMC 1000 was designed to ignite a passion for federal service for many students who never even have given a thought about an opportunity or a potential career in federal service. And be able to do that, you have to have an outreach. And so as we started a program, Academia Day, where once a quarter we would rotate to AMC centers, reach out in a 200-mile radius for all high schools and colleges and universities, and invite their career counselors to come. And then, of course, I would lead that off along with other senior leaders and talk about the opportunities in federal service for AMC, but also for the Army. I'm very proud of the fact the first year, I think we offered opportunities to over 1,200 students, and that's high school as well as college students. Some of those will turn into employment opportunities for them. After we initiated that first year, I think the department came on board to increase the number of internship opportunities that they are providing now. And now you're hearing about legislation potentially to allow us to make on the site offers as we go out and conduct job fairs at the various universities. That's a first, at least in a long time. And so that's a program designed to provide those opportunities. When I met with the interns here, just at this headquarters, about 40 of them last week, it was just so exciting to look out at them, to talk to them about the possibilities of a career service, and just to expose them to what is open for them as a potential career choice or career field as they go forward. So I'm excited about that program. We also have worked very hard to provide a positive and a quality work environment for employees. And so through our HR to provide these resiliency type courses and training available for our employees, because we want to ensure that they're staying healthy. And so programs that talk about nutrition, the importance of sleep, the importance of exercise, and to provide them an environment, a safe environment to work within. We've invested annually for the last 3 years over $150 million in our quality work environment. So improving the facilities or in the industrial base facilities, as well as improving the workplace at our various headquarters for our employees. So all of that contributes to a positive work climate, a positive work environment, a safe and healthy work environment, and that to me will help us as we generate the future force for our organization.
Yes, sir. So let's talk about Redstone Arsenal for a minute. Yes. You talk about it being the first permanent home for the command. Yes. We've now been here for a few years. Yes. We've set our foothold here, if you will. Where do you see the future of Redstone?
Well, again, very, very positive. The one thing about this community, they understand the value of having Redstone Arsenal, the community in Madison and Huntsville. They understand the value of having Redstone Arsenal here. You see it in their senior leadership, the elected officials, and how they value what this installation brings to the Tennessee Valley. They demonstrate that twice annually, doing Heroes Week and Armed Forces Week. They don't just celebrate one day, they celebrate a week. And when they bring the wounded warriors in and their families, I remember Linda and I were speaking to some of the wounded warrior spouses, and they said, we never had an opportunity to do this. You know, their spouses have suffered these devastating injuries, and they're trying to work themselves back to a quality of life and back to health. And to be able to bring them here and allow them to go out on these fishing boats and to be able to have other activities for them, they culminated with a ball where they are able to take their minds off of the everyday medical routines that they're in and the stresses that those families face. That's remarkable. And then, of course, Armed Forces Week, where they have a week of activities that allows us to reach out to the community. That's very special as well. We just celebrated the 75th anniversary of Redstone Arsenal, a significant milestone for a facility that started out of necessity in World War II as a munitions location, today being a global powerhouse in terms of missile defense, aviation, logistics, contracting, and a federal center of excellence with the campus of the FBI, the ATF, and certainly NASA's always had a large footprint and stance here. And so it's a remarkable installation. It's got a tremendous relationship with the local communities. It's going to continue to grow and thrive. And I think it's well postured to be very, very successful in the future. It has the right diversity in terms of the types of organizations and the type of missions that are performed here. And so it truly is a Department of Defense and Federal Center of Excellence. And having AMC here as a only one of three four-star Army commands in the world, in the United States, the other two being the Training and Doctrine Command at Fort Eustis and Forces Command at Fort Bragg, this has elevated Redstone Arsenal on that level within the Department of the Army. And so I think it's very promising.
Sir, a tough question. What's next for you?
Well, beginning to get that question a little bit more often, especially as I approach the fourth year in command. And I think first and foremost is, you know, probably need to take a little bit of time and pay some dividends back to my family. You know, Linda has, she's been with me along this entire way, you know, and I've always attempted to strike that balance between the mission, taking care of our employees, and of course, taking care of my own family. It's challenging to do that because the jobs that I've had, and especially in this command, a global organization performing the mission that we have to perform each and every day. I know even though I don't intend it to be that way, Linda knows sometimes that the mission comes first. And so I owe that to her. I owe it to our sons to be able to spend a little bit more time with them. Again, I've tried to balance and be in their lives as they were growing up. But there were many times I wasn't able to be there. And so I owe that to them as they are now young men and continuing in their careers. And then, of course, our mothers, we're very fortunate to have our mothers still with us. And so just to be able to spend a little quality time rather than just sort of popping in on a Saturday or Sunday and then leaving right away without really spending some time and doing some things for them that I just haven't had the time and luxury to be able to do. And then probably just a little time for me to break contact a little bit. You know, being in command as long as I have, and then the previous 16 months as a deputy, I've been on for a long time. But I've enjoyed it, and I think I've been able to balance the mission and the responsibilities, but also know that, you know, even with marathon runners, at some point in time, you've got to get off the trail and take a little bit of a break. So I look forward to that. And then secondarily, at some point in time, I'm going to look for opportunities to be able to give back, especially to our youth and to others, especially the nation and the opportunities that it has afforded a small town boy as myself from Martinsville, Virginia. And so, and I look forward to opportunities to maybe be able to do that someday. I don't know what that will be. The good Lord has always had a good plan. I've never had to worry about what was next. And so I feel fortunate and blessed that something will come. And I hope it'll be something that I have as much of a passion for as I've had for being a leader in our Army.
Well, thank you again so much for sharing your insight and reflecting back on what's certainly been an amazing journey for you. Before we close out, any final thoughts?
Well, just that I'm deeply appreciative to the United States Army and our nation for affording me this opportunity and the privilege to be able to serve as the commanding general of the United States Army Materiel Command. And I hope in some way that I've made it a better place, a stronger command, and set the conditions for the organization to continue to thrive after I exit the stage and hand it off to my successor. But I'm very, very thankful for the tremendous work that this entire organization, they followed my lead. Sometimes I'm certain they didn't quite agree with every direction that I wanted to go, but I think they had trust and confidence that I had their best interests at heart, even when some decisions appeared to not be in that way. And so I'm thankful for just all they've done to ensure that I was able to have a successful command tour and be able to meet the mission requirements that we have all around the world. And certainly wish all of them the very, very best for their continued success. And while I will leave, maybe I'll leave a little of myself and my family here with AMC, I'm certainly going to take a whole lot of AMC with me and wherever we go in the future.
Thank you again.
Thanks so much. It's a pleasure.